Yes, yes, folks, here for another episode of Man of Real. Today I'm going to be talking about a little movie that came on Netflix a couple of weeks back called Leave the World Behind. Leave the World Behind stars Julia Roberts, Mahershala Ali, Kevin Bacon, Ethan Hawke, and a new young lady actress I've not seen before going by the name of Mahala. A upper middle class white family do a house rent out in Long Island for a much needed break, and shenanigans ensue when they're confronted by the house's actual owners, played by a middle class black family, or one half of the black family, or two thirds, let's say, played by Mahershala Ali and Mahala. So they bring news of a blackout that engulfed New York City and that has turned them back to their house. The question is, with all this suspicion, are they telling the truth? And what in darnation is going on if they are? This movie was also directed by Sam Esmail, who directed a TV show called Mr. Robot, which had a lot of talk when it was out, did very well as a TV show that I saw starring Julia Roberts, which is obviously where he met Julia Roberts, called Homecoming. So I was a fan of his style of filmmaking, his taste and his intelligence. As a concoction, writer, director, that cast, I was excited. The question is, does it do that cast, that talent, behind and in front of the camera justice? From the get-go, the first sort of 5 minutes in, you're back in that sort of Sam Esmail aesthetic. It's a very stylish aesthetic, very precise. With the lines, with the cinematography, with the angles, it's kind of a Hitchcockian, Fincher type of style. I really appreciated it in TV form. The question always is, do these things transpose to movie form? And that was my one question I had for Sam Esmail with this. Yeah, I would also throw Shyamalan in there as well in regards to the influences that I feel he's got a little bit of that Shyamalan, but not quite as individualistic, I want to say. He's not quite as idiosyncratic as Shyamalan. But what's interesting is they have both made a similar catastrophe, end of the world type movie, and I will be talking about those comparisons. Getting back to Shyamalan, there is definitely a comparison between these two films. I heard critics compare them, so that gave me a sense of an inkling into what kind of film Leave the World Behind would be. One of the reviewers said that Leave the World Behind was a better film. I kind of thought they might have been being sarky, just because there's a tendency now to pile on with Shyamalan and sort of give him a bit of a kicking. Even though I think he's still doing stellar, idiosyncratic, yet mainstream work. But in the end, having seen the film, weighing it all up, I would say that that reviewer was more or less correct. Leave the World Behind is probably better in all departments than Knock at the Cabin. But in Knock at the Cabin, you could argue, is braver and is doing something more ambitious. And that maybe speaks to the filmmakers that are Sam Esmail and M. Night Shyamalan. So yeah, thinking about it, I would say that technically, Leave the World Behind is, and in more departments, a stronger film. But perhaps overall, Knock at the Cabin has a stronger message and is braver. It's more audacious for reasons I won't get into now, but you can check out my review on that, plug plug, which I reviewed earlier this year here, maybe. Ultimately, though, even though they're similar movies, they are, in the end, different stories with vastly different outcomes. Using panic and end of the world sort of shenanigans and sort of paranoia that comes with these sort of strange events happening. Human tendency to blame your fellow man when you can't explain things yourself. All are ingredients that make these two films similar, but in the end they do have very different outcomes. So let's talk about all four leads. I thought they were all really, really strong, and they kind of need to be, because ultimately, like Knock at the Cabin, this is a character study. Even more so, actually, it's a psychological study of these four characters, and, well, four plus the kids, I guess, but mainly Ethan Hawke, Julia Roberts, Mahershala Ali and Mahala. In a way, the film is an excuse to have conversations that you wouldn't normally have between different types of people who happen to be American, but with different sort of cultural references and backgrounds. And you obviously, you can't get more different than black and white in a lot of ways in the world and in America, obviously they have their own take on race relations. They're all very different. You've got prickly, jaded, world-weary Julia Roberts. You've got cowardly lion Ethan Hawke. You've got stoic, careful, intelligent Mahershala Ali, and you've got Jen, I don't know if it's X or Z, but you've got young girl who thinks she knows it all at 23, I think she is in the film, who has a sarky comment pitched to anyone who sort of comes into her vicinity, particularly Julia Roberts. In a way, four very distinct stereotypes that are squished together with an outcome forced. It's fascinating and intriguing to watch. Of the four leads, it's probably Ethan Hawke who I found to be the most continuously interesting, who may have had the most clear arc in a lot of ways. He starts off really, really cowardly. He's sort of quietly being dominated by Julia Roberts' wife, and it's clear that he has issues with his own masculinity and sort of being the man. He's this sort of trendy bohemian professor guy, you know, who's never probably had to try too hard. A lot of life has probably come to him. And yeah, he's forced with this impending potential catastrophe, and his reaction to it is way more panic than he's comfortable with. His journey you can really track. He's the one character where you feel like he has the most satisfying outcome, perhaps, even though we have a better sense of what might be going on. The characters are in no way out of the woods, but he gets to work some things through the most.
You know, get one of those, some rabbit ears or something.
Why would a rabbit's ear help?
Sam Esmail handles the impending cranked up tension very well. As I mentioned, has a very sort of considered, precise style. He seems very well suited, and the dialogue and direction are crisp. They really are intentional. So let's talk about the ending. Some of you won't have liked it. I'm sure about that. It doesn't go for out and out satisfaction, let me put it to you that way. I didn't like it initially. I was like, what? And then about an hour or so later, it settled into me and I was like, okay, I'm not mad at this ending. I can obviously see why people weren't too happy, but I think on that second consideration an hour later, I realized that the film had said all it kind of needed to say. I kind of compare it to having a really good meal and being hungry still and wanting to go for seconds, but knowing that if you have seconds, you're going to get too full up and feel a bit sick. And it was a little bit like that, really. It's kind of like you could have had seconds, you could have seen more, but really the case study and the thesis was all there within the film. It was the confusion. It was this experiment on people. And I won't say it more than that for fear of sort of giving away too much. And the film is happy leaving it there and having the audience be intrigued, because there's a lot going on and there's a lot to digest. And clearly the questions that they maybe have answers for within the film will have to continually be pushed up against. I thought this was a really strong film all in all. Extremely strong performances and direction front and center. It kept me at the edge of my seat, intrigued, asking questions in the right way and thinking about chewing on some of the conversations they had, political and otherwise. It's entertainment, but it also sparks just enough, like, oh, that's a good point. Oh yeah, I didn't see it that way. You're kind of thinking that along the way. I gotta say, Netflix last year, this time with Glass Onion and other such films, I didn't think their festive package was as strong as what this year is shaping up to be. I'm thinking about Leave the World Behind. I'm thinking about The Killer. I'm thinking about Maestro. These are really, really strong movies. So props to Netflix for getting it right this time around. They're varied and interesting and very high level. They're all cinema and not just streaming movies. Like, you could just as well watch Leave the World Behind in the cinema and enjoy it just as well. I definitely think that this one will have families, your family, captivated. It's kind of intergenerational. You know, your mum and your grandma and your teenage kid can all sit down and watch this, because there's a character representing everybody, and get different things from depending on who you relate to within the film too, and then talk about the outcome. It's left open enough that it's open to interpretation. I think my favorite scene is a scene between Mahershala Ali and Mahala, where he's in bed with her. It's not as inappropriate as it sounds, and they're having a discussion about where they're situated within the house, even though it's their house. I found that quite telling, and it sort of is one of those conversations which is at the heart of the film itself and what the film's about. So yeah, that is a scene that I really, really loved, and I think encompasses the film that Ishmael and team made. And a special shout out has to go to My Heart Hala. I wouldn't say she stands out more than Ethan Hawke or Mahershala, but she holds her own and she plays the part that she's hired to play sort of pitch perfectly. You can absolutely see that type of precocious, entitled know-it-all who knows she's sort of gorgeous and the world is in front of her. She hits all the notes. So props to her for holding her own. I will look out for her from here on in, really, because I'd be interested to see how her career progresses and where it all goes. But what did you think, most importantly? Don't forget to subscribe, by the way, and don't forget to like. And yeah, what did you think of Leave the World Behind? Who was the character that you related with and why? What did you think of the ending? Did you feel like it essentially said everything it needed to say within the thesis that was the movie, or were you genuinely hungry for more? And what do you think will become of those four characters and their kids, of course? How do you think it all ends? Leave your comments, like, subscribe, see you on the next one. Big up yourselves. Till next time, keep it real. Boom.
Well, as many of you know, I'm also a filmmaker. Consider watching my stuff and sharing your thoughts. The episodes can be found here and probably here. We've made a little web series. Do check it out, share your thoughts, and donate if you can. There's lots of giveaways, and the link can be found below in the description.